Penguin Random House Audio presents The Wages of Destruction, The Making and Breaking of the Nazi Economy, by Adam Tooze. Read for you by Simon Vance with Adam Tooze.
This book is dedicated to my grandparents, Peggy and Arthur Wynne, with thanks for the example that they always provided.
Preface.
How was this possible? In 1938, the Third Reich embarked on Germany's second campaign of conquest and destruction in less than a generation. At first, Hitler's Wehrmacht seemed unstoppable, better prepared and more aggressive than the Kaiser's armies, but as Hitler charged from victory to victory, his enemies multiplied. For the second time, a German bid to dominate the continent of Europe ran up against overwhelming opposition. By December 1941, the Third Reich was at war not only with the British Empire and the Soviet Union, but with the United States as well. It took 3 years and 5 months, but in the end, Hitler went down to a defeat far more cataclysmic than that which felled the Kaiser. Germany, along with large swaths of the rest of Eastern and Western Europe, was left in ruins. Poland and the Western Soviet Union were practically eviscerated. France and Italy lurched perilously close to civil war. The overseas empires of Britain, France, and the Netherlands were shaken beyond repair. And as the world learned of the extraordinary genocide committed by the National Socialist regime, the superiority once confidently claimed for European civilization was thrown forever into question. How was this possible? People make their own history. In the last instance, human will, both individual and collective, must be the starting point for any account of Nazi Germany. If we are to understand the awful deeds of the Third Reich, we must seek to understand their perpetrators. We must treat Adolf Hitler and his followers seriously. We must seek to penetrate their mindset and to map the dark interstices of their ideology. It is not for nothing that biography, both individual and collective, is one of the most illuminating ways to study the Third Reich. But if it is true that people make their own history, it is also true, as Karl Marx put it, that they do not make it just as they please. They do not make it under circumstances chosen by themselves, but under circumstances directly encountered, given, and transmitted from the past. What then are these circumstances? Somewhat surprisingly, for those who think of him as a simplistic economic determinist, Marx followed up his famous aphorism, not with a disquisition on the mode of production, but with a paragraph about the way in which the tradition of all the dead generations weighs like a nightmare on the brain of the living. Historical actors, just when they seem engaged in revolutionizing themselves and the things, anxiously conjure up the spirits of the past and borrow from them names, battle cries, and costumes that allow the new scene of world history to be dressed up in time-honored disguise. Hitler and his cronies certainly inhabited such a self-fashioned world. And it is with good reason, therefore, that recent writing on the Third Reich has been preoccupied with politics and ideology, the cultural crises of early 20th century Europe, the vacuum left by the secularizing tendencies of the late 19th century, the radicalizing horror of World War I, all demand attention from anyone seriously interested in plumbing the deeper motives of National Socialism. How else can we understand a regime that took as its central objective the destruction of European Jewry, an objective apparently devoid of all economic rationale, a project that, if it can be understood at all, seems to be intelligible only in terms of a violent theology of redemptive purification? The cultural and ideological turn in the study of fascism has permanently remodeled our understanding of Hitler and his regime. It is hard to imagine now, but there was a time, not so long ago, when historians routinely dismissed Mein Kampf as a historical source and thought it reasonable to treat Hitler as just another opportunistic imperialist. Those days are gone. Thanks to the work of two generations of historians, we now have a far better understanding of the way in which Nazi ideology conditioned the thought and action of the Nazi leadership and wider German society. But whilst we have been busy unravelling the central ideological and political thread of Hitler's regime, other crucial strands of the story have been relatively neglected. Most notably, historians have tended to downplay or even ignore the importance of the economy. In part, this has been a deliberate act of rejection. In part, the marginalisation of economic history has been self-inflicted. The statistical terminology in which much economic history is couched is inaccessible to readers trained in the humanities, and too little effort has been made by either side to bridge the gap. Perhaps, most of all, the turn against socio-economic analysis has been motivated by a sense of ennui, the impression that there's simply nothing new to say, that all the major questions were answered by the first two generations of historians and social scientists writing after 1945, who seized on such topics as the Nazi economic recovery or the history of the war economy. What we are left with is a historiography moving at two speeds. Whereas our understanding of the regime's racial policies and the inner workings of German society under National Socialism has been transformed over the last 20 years, the economic history of the regime has progressed very little. The aim of this book is to start a long overdue process of intellectual realignment. To do so, this book reassesses the archival and statistical evidence, much of which has gone unquestioned in 60 years, brings it into dialogue with the latest research, both by historians of the Third Reich and by economic historians exploring the dynamics of the interwar economy, and asks what light this throws on some of the central questions in the history of Hitler's regime. How did the fissures in the global power structure created by the Great Depression of 1929 to 1932 enable Hitler's government to have such a dramatic impact on the world scene? What was the relationship between the extraordinary imperial ambition of Hitler and his movement, and the peculiar situation of the German economy and society in the 1920s and 1930s? How did domestic and international economic tensions contribute to Hitler's drive to war in 1939 and his restless drive to widen the war thereafter? When and how did the Third Reich develop the Blitzkrieg strategy that is widely seen as the hallmark of its spectacular success in World War II? When the Blitzkrieg failed outside Moscow in December 1941, how did the Third Reich continue the war for almost 3.5 years against overwhelming material odds? And what are we to make of Albert Speer? In recent years, this singular figure has attracted an extraordinary amount of attention. Yet, and it's surely a sign of the times, what has been in the foreground has not been Speer's primary function as armaments minister, but questions relating to his role as Hitler's architect, Speer's personal knowledge of the Holocaust, and his tortured efforts after 1945 to come to terms with the truth. This book is the first in 60 years to offer a truly critical account of the performance of the German war economy, both under Speer and his predecessors, and it casts stark new light on his role in sustaining the Third Reich to its bloody end. For it is only by re-examining the economic underpinnings of the Third Reich, by focusing on questions of land, food and labour, that we can fully get to grips with the breathtaking process of cumulative radicalisation that found its most extraordinary manifestation in the Holocaust. The first aim of this book, therefore, is to reposition economics at the centre of our understanding of Hitler's regime, by providing an economic narrative that helps to make sense of and underpin the political histories produced over the last generation. No less urgent, however, is the need to bring our understanding of the economic history of the Third Reich into line with the subtle but profound rewriting of the history of the European economy that has been ongoing since the late 1980s, but has gone largely unnoticed in the mainstream historiography of Germany. It's hardly an exaggeration to say that historians of 20th century Germany share at least one common starting point, the assumption of the peculiar strength of the German economy. Obviously, when Hitler took power, Germany was in the midst of a deep economic crisis. But the common sense of 20th century European history is that Germany was an economic superpower in waiting, an economic force comparable only to that of the United States. For all the argument there has been over the backwardness or otherwise of German political culture, the assumption of Germany's peculiar economic modernity has gone largely unquestioned. This assumption frames the writing of much of German social history, as much as it also informs accounts of German imperialism in the foreign policy field. Indeed, so influential has been the assumption of Germany's economics.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.